Praise God. Yeah, the church, we have, a lot of people are away, but we are very special. So this is a special message for very special people. Hallelujah. Shall we pray? Father, we look to you, O God. As we have tasted, each one of us have tasted your love, your compassion, your tenderness, and your mercies in our lives, Lord. This morning we pray. We want to hear your voice. Lord, we long to have you speak to us. Lord, give us listening ears. And Lord, give us hearts that are tender, that you can move our hearts even as we hear you speak to us. Lord, I pray that you would give me the grace, the anointing, the humility, the courage that I need to bring forth your word, Lord, that you want to bring to your precious people here this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, church, you know that I've been talking this year on the theme. Anybody remembers the theme? Worship. Praise God. Praise God. So, the theme for this year, we have been thinking about worship and the fact that we do come here for a worship service and we have a worship team here who leads us. But that's only part of worship. Most of the worship in our life happens after the worship service. So what God wants of us is to have a life of worship in which we honor Him. So in connection with the theme, we looked at where the word worship comes first in the Bible, and we saw that it is in Genesis. And it is in relation to the story, the fact that when Abraham was asked to offer Isaac as a sacrifice, that is the first time the word worship comes. When Abraham said, we will go and worship and come back. So the first time the worship comes in relation to a offering of a sacrifice. And there were four principles that we said that that incident teaches us about a life of worship. Anybody remembers? Number one is listening to God. When we are worshipers of God, we will listen. We'll be sensitive. We'll take effort to hear God. And number two, just like Abraham, when he was called, he was immediately said, yes, Lord, here am I. And second thing is obedience to God. When we hear, we obey. So Abraham heard the voice of God. And God told him, you go and offer your son, your only son, and offer him as a sacrifice. And we see the next verse we read where it says that early the next morning, Abraham with his son and his servants got ready and started moving. So second is obedience. Listening, obeying, and the third thing is he trusted God. He told when he was here, nearing the place where he and his son had to go and for the offerings or the sacrifice to happen, his servants asked, where are you going? What will happen and all? So he said, no, we will go and come back. So he knew that even if Isaac is to be sacrificed, God is able to raise him up. So he had such faith. So listen to God, obey God, trust God, and then finally willing to make the sacrifice before God. Whatever he asks you to sacrifice, you know that he is a loving God and he doesn't want to do you any harm. He wants to bless you. So as you offer that sacrifice, that becomes a channel of blessing. Even though it may look very precious to you, as you let go, something more precious will happen. So listen, obey, trust, and be willing to make the sacrifice that God is calling you to make. So we began with that, and then we looked at the portions where the word sacrifice or offering or altar, building of an altar comes. All those are related to worship to God. Different ways people worship God at different times. And how worship is pleasing to God. We looked at Noah when he came after all that happened, he came out and then he offered a sacrifice to God. And then the Bible says that it was God smelt the pleasing aroma of the sacrifice, and God was so pleased. And then he made this covenant that no more the earth will be destroyed by floods, the whole earth will not be destroyed. So worship is pleasing to God. We also then looked at the fact that worship, whenever you are in a warfare, worship overcomes the enemy. And we looked at so many instances where it was through worship that the battles were won. When you don't know what to do, you are in a very tight spot, difficult situation, lift up your hands and open your mouth and worship God. And as you worship, you will see the enemy defeated. You will see you have the energy to overcome. You will see God giving you directions and pathways to pass through the fire. And worship is the way. And then finally, last time we saw that in worship, it is not only we offer animals whom we sacrifice, and in the Old Testament it was that. You bring an animal, of course precious, costly, but you kill the animal, and that was a sacrifice. But in the New Testament, we looked at Romans chapter 12, and we saw God is asking us to be a living sacrifice. Offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, which is pleasing to God, a reasonable worship. So there is offer in that one verse, there is offering, there is sacrifice, and there is worship, all three together. Present your bodies as a living sacrifice, every part of our body. And then we close with that song, beautiful song, which sings, you offering our eyes, our hands, our feet, our heart, everything to God as a sacrifice, as a living sacrifice. So today, I thought I had finished with the worship, but today, this message was to come actually many weeks ago. As Sally has already shared the testimony, I was to bring this message here on, I think on the 25th of last month. But on the 22nd, we had to suddenly rush out to Ludhiana. And then we came back, and then I was to give this message 2 weeks ago. But that Friday night, I started coughing, and Saturday I was at work, and then I was coughing. And I knew something was going wrong. By evening, I was running fever. Then I had to tell Pastor that I'm sorry, I don't think I'll be able to come. So both of us were down with COVID for a week. And thank God, all the 2 years ago, when everything was so miserable, very bad, we didn't get it. And so now we got it, but then it was not so bad. We could breathe, and we didn't need oxygen, and God is so gracious and merciful. He knows where to put us through what we can go through. And just to also share the testimony, when we were in Ludhiana, Sally's brother is very close to me because we were together in college. We were best friends in our student group. And for him to go through this was for me very painful. So I didn't know how I will face it. In the morning, he had to be taken for angiogram. And But that morning, you know, I have always read this thing, you know, the you pray and with thanksgiving present your request to God, and the peace of God which passeth all understanding. But many situations I had not experienced that peace which is beyond understanding. But the morning when we reached there on Thursday, Friday morning, he was to have the angiogram, we took him to the hospital and everything was being processed. That morning, I had absolute peace. Peace which beyond understanding. And God gave me that morning a promise that he will be healed. And so before we took him for the angiogram, I told him, you know, Laji, you are healed. Then he asked me, what do you mean? You think I won't need anything to be done? I said, that I don't know. But I said, you have received healing. So that gave me so much of peace, even when he was going for the angiogram, even after the angiogram, the doctor called and showed us the angio, discussed the things. But there was a peace. And then when we had to share it with him, I didn't know how he will take it. And he said, yeah, I had already seen the angio, I know I need surgery. So it was very easy for us to prepare him for that. So God in his mercy takes us through various experiences to reveal to us his mercy and his compassion and his tenderness. So this morning, the theme for what we will discuss together is the fact that intimacy with God is the key to a life of worship. Intimacy, the key in our walk with God. Now, I know that all of us have our time with God. We all are people, especially in New Life Fellowship in Dubai, even though we all are busy, we are taught to have our personal quiet time, to spend time with God every day. And that is building our intimacy with God, hearing God through his word, praying, praising, thanksgiving. Now, so why should I talk about this? I am talking about this again to refresh us. You know, in Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 1, Paul says, I know that you live in order to please God, as in fact you are doing. But Paul says, now we ask you and urge you to do this more and more. So when I talk about this, share about the need for intimacy, I'm saying that we need to grow in it more and more and more. So may our life of worship become so intimate with God that it is more than what it was last year, more than what it was last month. And Paul also in the same chapter, verse 10, he says, in fact, you do love all the brothers throughout Macedonia. And Paul says, yet we urge you, brothers, to do this more and more. So may God help us, even as we focus on this theme of worship and this life of worship, that God will woo us into a life of more and more intimacy with him. Through the experiences that we go through, and that through the time and the effort that we make, and we tell God, Lord, I want to be more intimate with you. I want to listen to your voice. I want to spend time with you. How do we develop intimacy? How do we get to know one another? If I love my wife, I will spend time with her. So the way God will look at my heart, my desire to be intimate with him, you know, in marriage seminars, and they always talk about the most important thing about marriage is communication, communication, communication. Have you heard that? Any relationship, the key is communication. If I don't talk to my wife for 4 or 5 days, that means I don't love her. Okay, so communication with God is the key way I express my desire for Him. We sang such lovely songs this morning. I love you, Lord. But the way God knows I love Him is my desire for Him, how much time I spend in talking to Him, to listening to Him, and listening to Him through His Word. So we can grow in it. God is expecting us to grow in it. And today, in order to look at this intimacy and life of worship, I thought we would look at some of the people in the Bible who prominently led a life of worship. So, as time permits, we will look at, we'll first take the Old Testament, and we will look at the people who led a life of worship. And some of this may be a repetition, but I think, as I said earlier, you know, let us grow in our life of worship more and more. Whose name comes to you from the Old Testament when you think of worship? David, yes. All the Psalms you read, you know that David was so longing for intimacy with Him. Anybody else before David? Moses, yes. Moses is another person. Very good. Moses was another person whose life was a life of worship. We can learn principles from his life. Anybody else before Moses? Abraham, yes. Abraham was another person who led a life of worship. As we began the whole Bible, the first word of worship comes is relating to Abraham. So let us see whether what we can learn from Abraham and from Moses and from David. And there are two more people in the New Testament. I don't know whether we'll have time to go into that. You know, Pramita mentioned two Marys in the New Testament. So precious people. Their life, indeed a life of worship. So, when we come to, interestingly, when you look at these three characters in the Old Testament, Abraham, Moses, and David, these worshippers waited for years for the fulfillment of God's promise in their lives. Waiting for God is a part of God's plans for His true worshippers. Anybody of you, anybody here waiting for God to do something in your lives? Just remember, God gives waiting time for the people whom He loves dearly to draw them, prepare them for something very special. Hallelujah. Abraham waited 25 years. Moses had 40 years in the wilderness. 40 long years. David was anointed, young man. Maybe he was 14 or 15. And then he had all the struggle to go through. At the age of 30, he becomes fulfillment of the promise. So may God encourage those of you here among us who have been waiting. Waiting for God. You had the promises, you thought this will happen. I remember for my brothers recently, Laji's, when I went, I thought, okay, maybe his angio will be normal. But it was not normal. Then I was thinking that, okay, it may be an angioplasty. It was not that. Then it was surgery. But then the God's plan, God's purpose, today he may have already reached Manali now. He was on his way this morning. But God perfects all things beautifully. We sang that song, no? Ascribe greatness to the Lord because he is a just God. Justice will be done. Even if we don't see it happen today in my life, somebody is, you know, being bad to us and we don't see justice. But remember, God makes all things just and perfect. Hallelujah. He is a God of justice. So it will happen. So just remember these few words: intimacy with God. Number two, waiting. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Isaiah 13:9. Now when we look at Abraham's life, what was the most important thing Abraham is mentioned for? Faith, yes. In Genesis chapter 15, it says, Abraham believed God. Verse 6, it says, Abram believed God, and he credited it to him as righteousness. We see the same thing in James chapter 2 also. The same thing is mentioned. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Abraham just believed. God said, you go unto this place, far away from you, leave your family, everything, and you go, and I will bless you. Abram at that time just believed it, and he started going. Is there anything that God has spoken to you in your life? May God help you to believe it today. Believe it, have faith in it. May God bring back to your remembrance, have faith in it, and it will come to pass in his time. But wait with God for the promise to be fulfilled. It was not easy. You know, he went through Abraham's life, you know, he went through so many different things. But even though his faith many times looked weak, because he listened to Sarah and then did not wait for Sarah to have the child. Then Ishmael was born. But yet, God in his mercy, God is a covenant-keeping God. God made a covenant with Abraham and then he kept it. So in your lives, in my life, in our lives, God's covenant can be trusted. What a beautiful thing this morning we take part in the communion. You know, God made a covenant with Abraham, and for that sake, even for generations later, even now, God is keeping that covenant. You see Israel as a nation, it is God's covenant. So thousands of years ago, it is being fulfilled. So God is a covenant-keeping God. God spoke to Abraham, and he kept that covenant. And Jesus said, this is my the blood of my new covenant. And as we partake of that, we can be so sure. We are reminded, and Jesus on the cross shed his blood. That is a covenant that is sealed for eternity. Anyone who calls upon him and trusts in him will not go into hell. He will keep them for eternal life. That is the covenant we can be so confident of. There are so many other things we are confident of. You know, when we go to bed in the morning, we think we are sure we'll get up and the sun will rise. But then this covenant of God in Jesus is so much stronger than any other things that we can think of. But it is a mystery. We cannot understand that God, the Almighty God, will become man and will suffer and will die on the cross and will cry, my God, why have you forsaken me? And that when we as human beings, sinful as we are, dirty as we are, when we call upon him, he will come into our lives, he will dwell in our lives. It's a mystery. That's why Paul says that, you know, pray that God will give me the courage and the protect me so that I may proclaim the mystery of the gospel whenever I have an opportunity. It's a mystery, but it is real. It is truth. It is powerful. It is eternal. Second thing about Abraham, what is the second thing? Abraham is a man of faith. He's mentioned all over in the New Testament about faith. Second thing about Abraham, yes, obedience, but in relation to God, Abraham was the friend of God. Friendship with God. Jesus told the disciples, I don't call you my servants, but I call you my friends. You know, God, the God of the whole universe, the creator of all things for whom nothing is impossible, Almighty God, is my friend. Hallelujah. He's your friend. Hallelujah. Just take your name and say that God is my friend. God is my friend. God is Jason's friend. Hallelujah. Praise God. And Abraham was a friend of God. You know, when God had decided, he came down, he had decided to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And then in Genesis chapter 8, God says, shall I, verse 17, then the Lord says, shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do? I think in some versions it says, Abraham, my friend. And James chapter 2, verse 23 says, you know, Abraham was called a friend of God. You know, you and I have the privilege to be in that relationship. How friendship is so good. When you have a good friend at whatever stage you are in life, it's so nice. You feel nice talking to him. You feel so good when something good happens to him. You feel so good to have him around in your situations. And God was Abraham's friend. Because Abraham led a life of worship, listening to God, trusting God, obeying God, trusting God, and willing to make the sacrifice. And Abraham, when he came out from his country, his people, and came away, and then he decided in chapter 13 of Genesis, we see Abraham and Lot, they all have enough, plenty of animals. Lot, his nephew, was there with him. Then Abraham decided, God said to separate. So then Abraham gives Lot the first preference to do whatever he wants. Choose whatever best you want. Because Abraham was so confident that God will meet all his needs. And God will keep his covenant. Anybody else may want to take advantage, doesn't matter. Somebody may be now trying to play the politics in your department, in where you're working. Don't worry. God will take care of you. Your portion is secure in God. And then when he moves out, he comes to the place in Genesis chapter 13. It says, Abraham moved his tents and went to live near the great tree of Mamre in Hebron, where he built an altar to the Lord. And the word Hebron, I'm told, I've written it in my Bible. Somebody must have told me the meaning of it. It means fellowship with God. So when you move away, when God tells you, you leave your people, you leave something which is dear to you, you separate and you come away to worship God, your fellowship with God becomes more intimate. So when you think of the life of Abraham, a man who led a life of worship, you think of his faith, you think of your faith increasing more and more, trusting in God, listening to God, obeying God, and sacrificing. Whatever God asks you to sacrifice, it is not, can never be too costly, because what He gives back will be so much more valuable. If you sacrifice something which you, of course, everything you cannot give in price, in rupees or something, but whatever it be, you give up something to God, what He gives back will be much more. And if it is Jesus who is asking you to give something, you can be sure. May not be material, but your blessing will be very great. Now let's look at Moses. Again, Moses had to wait, I told you. But when I look at Moses' life, what is the most important thing God talks about Moses? What did God say about Moses to Miriam, remember, and Aaron? Okay, if you turn with me to Numbers chapter 12, it's written about Moses that Numbers chapter 12 talks about these incidents. Miriam and Aaron began to talk against Moses because of his Cushite wife, for he had married a Cushite. Has the Lord spoken only through Moses, they asked? Hasn't He also spoken through us? And the Lord heard this. Okay, verse 3 says, now Moses was a very humble man, more humble than anyone else on the face of the earth. Who is talking this? God is saying. It's recorded here. And then verse 4 says, at once the Lord said to Moses, Aaron and Miriam, come out to the tent of meeting, all three of you. So the three of them came out, and then the Lord comes down in a pillar, and then all the thing happens. And then God says in verse 6, it says, when a prophet, God is saying, listen to my words. When a prophet of the Lord is among you, I reveal myself to him in visions and I speak to him in dreams. But this is not true of my servant Moses. Moses is humble, and then God calls him. Abraham was my friend, and here calls Moses my servant. What a beautiful thing to be God's servant. You know, they call in Kerala, they say if you are a government servant, it is a good thing. You've got so many privileges. You get pension, you don't have to work hard, you can go whenever you want. Government servant is a great thing. But here, God's servant. Hallelujah. But this is not true of my servant Moses. He is faithful in all my house. Verse 8, with him I speak face to face, clearly, and not in riddles. He sees the form of the Lord. Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses? How God speaks about Moses. He is my servant. I speak to him face to face. He is so dear to me. He is so close to me. Other people, it is all in riddles and visions and all. But Moses, my servant, how dare you speak? That was the intimacy that Moses had with God, and God and Moses. But I want to tell you, this happens after 40 years of wilderness. But before the wilderness started, I see Moses, if you turn with me to Exodus chapter 3, chapter 1 maybe, we see Moses as a man with such a zeal for God. You see, Moses is in the palace, but he has a zeal for the people of Israel, children of God. He knew what was God's plan for them, and he wants to protect them. And then he sees the two Israelites fighting, and then he goes. First of all, he sees a Hebrew being attacked, being you know, ill-treated by the Egyptian, but he is full of zeal for his people, and so he kills the Egyptian because he had so much energy. He wanted to do everything possible to protect. And so God saw the zeal that Moses has for his people. Excuse me. And his purposes, his plans to come to pass. Sometimes in our zeal, we may do things prematurely. We may not be doing things all spiritually, but our heart of zeal is something God watches. And that is good. Don't be afraid. Today one sister was telling me this morning about the zeal that she has and how she told somebody, about Diwali. Somebody was telling, you're celebrating Diwali. So she said, you know, all about... She said how she has a God who is so different. Here in Diwali, they buy, she used to buy, or maybe she has seen people buying God for different prices. You can get a God for, 50 rupees or 100 rupees, you buy a God and you worship. Why did she do that? Because of the zeal of the Lord is upon her. So, God notices the zeal that you have. Do you have a zeal for God and for His things, for His kingdom, for His people? Even if you do some foolish things, it is okay, because God, we can still turn you, take you out of it all and fulfill His beautiful purposes. So God noticed the zeal that Moses had. And God took him and hid him for 40 years. In loneliness, but then at the appropriate time, in the fullness of time, God comes to Moses. And then everything begins. And then Moses is not ready. Are there people sitting here among us who has a promise from God, who had a zeal for God, but now it is cold? It has gone cold because of something that happened to you. Maybe something God didn't do which you wanted God to do, or there was a failure in your life. A failure. Or somebody told you, you are a failure. Is God speaking to somebody here? And then God is telling, in the fullness of time, He will come. And He will fulfill His purposes. And His plans, and He will pull you out. It is not that you can do it yourself, but God is going to come and He will pull you out of your hiding and then fulfill His purpose for your life. What a transformation for Moses. And what did God do through Moses? When God called Moses, He was to take the whole people. I don't know the exact number, but I know it definitely is more than a million. And Matthew said today morning it is 3 million. So it could be 3 million. So millions of people God was delivering and taking them. For what? Taking them to worship God. Hallelujah. What a glorious thing. If through us, if one person comes to the Lord and turns and he is able to worship God, what a joy. Here, Moses, from his hiding and absolute utter failure, God takes him to take millions of people out of bondage. And then So zeal for God, humility, humble before God, the most humble person on the face of the earth, but he is leading 3 million people. Hallelujah. And in his presence, God wants to dwell among them. And that's why the tabernacle was built. Again, relates to worship, intimacy, God and his people. And Moses is the one who used to lead them, and it is he is the leader among whom the God will find a resting place, the ark and the tabernacle, and Moses and God, the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud, all this intimate relationship with God. He had zeal and he was humble. And the third thing is, he was interested in God's glory more than anything else. He was very sure. Exodus 32, we see this instance when God, Moses is coming down. And Exodus 32 verse 9, God says, I have seen these people, the Lord said to Moses, and they are a stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone, so that my anger may burn against them, and that I may destroy them, and then I will make you into a great nation. What a great opportunity for Moses, that he will become a great nation. Do you know that none of his sons became anything? God gave, after Moses, the next was Joshua. And he has another story. You know, he was another person who intimately wanted God's presence. You know, even when Moses would leave, Joshua will be still there in the tabernacle. So, but here Moses says, but Moses sought the favor of the Lord his God. And he said, O Lord, he said, why should your anger burn against your people whom you brought out of Egypt with great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, it was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to wipe them off the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce anger. Relent and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember your servants, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self, I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give your descendants all this land I promised them, and it will be their inheritance forever. What was Moses concerned about? Not himself, but the glory of the Lord. How would the Egyptians know? What will they think about this God of the universe? You know, Jesus in John chapter 12, when he was going to be crucified, and it says in John chapter 12, Jesus, towards the end of the chapter, it says, he was so troubled in the spirit. And verse 27 says, now my heart is troubled, Jesus says. What shall I say, Father? Save me from this hour? No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Verse 28, Father, glorify your name. Jesus says, my heart is troubled. But when your heart is troubled, Jesus' concern is what? Oh Father, glorify your name. What is my greatest concern in the situation that I am in today? Is it glorify God? Or is it glorify me? My will be done? Or is it that that person should perish because he has done this thing to me? Or what is the thing? If there is a relationship problem, are you thinking what he has done, why should he do this to me? Why should do this? I have done this, blah, 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 all those kind of things. Or am I looking, how can God be glorified in this situation? What is the situation that you are in today? And what can you do to see that God is glorified? So Moses, his concern was the glory of God. And so that is why Moses was a true worshipper all his life. So to summarize, we looked at only two, we didn't go to David today. What is God telling? God is telling us he's happy with your worship, but he wants to do it more and more and more. He is happy with you. He's glad with your desire to spend time with him, but God is saying, I want more intimacy. More intimacy with you. I want to listen to you more. I want to have more communication with you. Daniel prayed 3 times a day. In the Orthodox, in the Greek and Syrian and all Orthodox churches, there is prayer for 7 times a day. Our cousins pray 5 times a day. But Jesus, whom we love, would like us to talk to him, return to him. And we looked at the life of Abraham, and we said faith, friendship, and sacrifice. We looked at Moses' life and zeal for God. Do not hold back. And in Romans 12, verse 11, it says, never be lacking in zeal, Paul is telling to the Roman church, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Let our zeal for God increase. But as our zeal increases, we become more and more humble. And we desire only one thing. The greatest thing that we desire is God to be glorified. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you, Lord God, for your desire for me and your desire for each one of us here, Lord. Every brother, every sister, you long. It's your heart to be intimate with us. Father, I pray, Lord God, this morning that you will be able to say of each one of us here that we are your friend. That you would be able to speak proudly of us like you spoke about Moses. My servant. Hallelujah. Give us the joy, Lord, in knowing that we are your friend and we can serve you. Lord, I pray for this church, O Lord God, that we will be a church of whom you can say, a church of people who love you, whose heart is so close to you. Father, I pray, Lord God, you would increase our zeal for you. Increase our trust in you, O God. Let us not be shaken, even as we sang today, Lord. The rock we will be confident in. Father, I pray this morning for especially for those who have lost the zeal because of something that happened in their life, maybe some failure, maybe some attack of the enemy. Father, I pray this morning, Lord, may you restore them. Restore the zeal in their lives for your purposes, O God. Father, I pray for those in their life situations, in a difficult position. Lord, they could easily do things which does not glorify you. Father, I pray for them, very specially this morning, Lord, where they could be taking an action on the basis of the flesh, on human wisdom. Lord, I pray, glorify your name. Let your glory alone be the heart's desire. How beautiful for us to be in that place where we can say, Lord, you be glorified, not me, not my will. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior and our precious Lord, our loving Savior, and the love of our God, eternal Father, covenant-keeping God, and the fellowship, the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with each one of us and our families and this church and its leaders. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.